Hi, it's Kernotex here with the next in the series of videos about installing Gentoo on a Raspberry Pi 400. So the previous video, I showed you how I managed to get a fully working graphical environment on Gentoo. This series is going to be more about getting the system up and running rather than putting certain packages on or even the graphical environment. I'll just be getting Gentoo up and running with a terminal. I won't be going into getting the desktop up because that's pretty generic. You know, it would be the same whether you're on a ARM or a 32-bit, 64-bit Intel. Now, what we need to do first of all is because the Gentoo installation will need a 64-bit kernel, and the Raspberry Pi by default comes as a 32-bit kernel and a 32-bit system, we need somehow to get the Raspberry Pi booted into a 64-bit environment. Now, originally when I think it was Raspberry Pi 3 came out, that was the first Raspberry Pi that was 64-bit capable, this was a real problem. But now the Raspberry Pi Foundation do provide a 64-bit kernel, which is in the boot. If I just list that up, it's this file here, kernel8.img. So, if you could just use this kernel, boot with that kernel, and would be in a 64-bit environment. I did investigate how it could be done manually, which is what this video is going to be about. It's going to be about creating our own 64-bit kernel from the 32-bit operating environment. So it's more of an educational value rather than an absolute necessity. So you can actually skip this video if you wish. If you wish to just go on to the next video to start the actual Gentoo installation. However, if you do want to see how I create a 64-bit kernel that we can boot from within this 32-bit environment, then, as I say, that's what this video is all about. And it will take roughly 2.5 hours, top end of 3 hours at the most, but should be about 2.5 hours. So as you can see, we're booting into 32-bit, which is what this ARM V7L is. That should say ARCH64 there for 64-bit. So that just shows that we are in 32-bit mode. One thing I will show just before I get on to the start of the kernel building is to demonstrate the GLX gears, how that differs slightly in the default Raspberry Pi environment. Now I think I might have already installed it on here. I've got to be the main user. Yeah, I've already installed it on here. A default Pi installation won't have this package installed, and you need to install a package called Mesa Utils. So if I install that, it should come back and say that it's already sudo. Yeah, it's already the newest version. So that's the package you need to install that if you want to run it yourself. So if I rerun it with the info command, and I scroll back, you can see again we've got the hardware rendering is active. I think it's this bit here, V3D 4.2. If it says anything else, then it's not hardware acceleration. You can see we've got the 60 frames a second. Again, it's locked to the refresh, I believe, of the monitor. However, if I enlarge this screen to what's nearly full screen, just leave that to run for 10 seconds or so we get a few new lines coming up. And then I'll minimize that. You'll see that the frame rate is actually a lot less than it was on the 32-bit side. it's 30 frames per second, whereas on the 64-bit that I'd built, I was getting minimum of 40 frames per second. Now, admittedly, there's some differences here. The 64-bit Raspberry Pi, I configured it to be overclocked as 2 gigahertz, and also there's the fact that it's a 64-bit operating system that may have had something to do with it. Plus, also, all the software had been custom compiled with some switches that may have improved the performance. So this sort of things, these sort of advantages you can get by compiling your own software. So that's worth bearing in mind. The other thing worth noting is that I think by default, when this is on the small screen, it actually uses less CPU than the version I used, and that could be one of the reasons why the 64-bit is not out of beta yet. It's still in testing. I guess they're wanting to improve it a lot more before they make it an official release. So that's why when you buy a brand new top of the range Raspberry Pi, the 400, the current model, it's still only booting to, by default, to a 32-bit operating system. And hence what we're doing is maybe something that's not quite stable in itself and could possibly be improved on in the future, as the 64-bit environment has done since it was first introduced by various people several years ago, probably about 5 years ago, I guess, when the Raspberry Pi 3, I think, came out in 2016. So it's worth bearing in mind that it's not identical to booting 32-bit, but in theory, you should be getting better performance out of the computer. So that's that. So what I'm going to do now is start building the environment for building the 64-bit kernel and show you how to boot into that and so on. So the first thing we need to do is I initially went to the Raspberry Pi Foundation webpage, and it's got a page here. If I just show you the address. Okay, well, yeah, in fact, if you put Raspberry Pi kernel building, you'll come up with this page as the first, as the first link. But that's the website there at the top if you want to type that in manually. And it does mention about cross-compiling here, but I had a great deal of trouble getting this to work, and it's probably my lack of knowledge of Ubuntu and probably the Raspberry Pi operating system as well. But this is a command I couldn't get to work. It wouldn't accept this. It would accept the 32-bit cross build essential package, but not this one, and I'm not sure why. I am assuming that this is the target architecture that you want and not the architecture that you're on, because it does suggest doing this on Ubuntu. So I'm assuming that it's it's for an ARM 64, not an Intel 64, unless it meant booting the Raspberry Pi with Ubuntu. I'm not sure. It wasn't completely clear to me. So I abandoned that and decided to have a go at building my own cross-compiler on the Raspberry Pi. And I did that successfully. And to do that, I used some notes from the Linux from Scratch web pages. So I went to the linuxfromscratch.org website, as you can see here, and I just clicked on here and then read online to read the book online, and this stable LFS will take us to the book. Now, there's one thing you may want to do first of all, but I'll tell you what's needed anyway to be able to build the two packages we're going to build, is this host system requirements. There's a script here if you've not used LFS before. If you copy and paste this script in, including the last line to execute it, and let's become root again. If I paste that in, it'll run and tell you what the system's capable of, whether it's capable of building Linux from scratch. Now, we don't need everything in here, actually. there are a couple of packages we need to install, but we don't need everything. For example, we don't need this make info package. I don't think we need Gawk installed, and the fact that Bash is not the default shell is not a problem either, but there are a couple of other packages we need to install, which is Bison and what was the other one? Oh, I think it was Flex. I can't actually see that there. Maybe not. It's not absolutely necessary. I did get a bit lost about what the requirements were, because when I was following this, it did actually say to install several packages to use this cross-compile package. So it could be that, yeah, Bison Flex there. So it could be Flex is not actually needed for what we're going to do. And I think some of these packages, like Make, was already on the system anyway. So maybe at one time when they were writing this page that these packages weren't on there. So it could be that, you know, tell you a couple of packages to install, then not strictly necessary, but there's no harm in putting in the command to install them. They'll either be there and they won't install, or install them anyway and you won't use them, so it's no big deal. But let's install these packages now. There's one we will need later on to download the kernel from the Raspberry Pi Foundation, because with this Gentoo installation, don't use the standard kernel from the Kernel Foundation, kernel.org. Use the Raspberry Pi one, basically because it's pre-configured to have all the hardware and all the binary blobs that are required to get the Raspberry Pi to work, and all its ancillary equipment, plus other equipment that you may have that you want to plug in. It's all pre-configured, so you don't have to go messing around too much with the configuration and so on. So we'll need Git, we'll need Bison. I'll put Flex in, although it looks like we probably don't need that at all. Then there's three other packages we'll need, because we're going to be building GCC as one of the packages to get a cross compiler. It's obviously we need a compiler that can build 64-bit for ARM. We need libgmpdev, libmpfrdev, and libmpcdev. So we need those packages there: Git, Bison, Flex, libgmpdev, libmpfrdev, and libmpcdev. And that should be the minimum number of packages. So I'll just let those install. And once that's installed, what I'll do is go back to the Raspberry Pi page. I'll get rid of this, like I said, it's just out of information, really. It's rather than a necessary thing. But the two pages we need out of this is we're going to build the bin utils and GCC. And if you're interested in what I'm actually doing here, what I've decided to do to do the cross-compile, if you look at this, this table here, we're building bin utils and GCC stage one. And basically, if you see the build and host columns is the PC, so you could read that as the Raspberry Pi 32-bit. What we're doing is we're building bin utils and GCC for the target, which is going to be the Raspberry Pi 64-bit. So it's only this first stage we're doing. We don't need to build the second or third stages, because we're not building a complete system at this point. The way Gentoo works is they deliver you a partially built system, like the core of a system based on a 64-bit system. But we do need a kernel to be able to use that system. That system needs a 64-bit environment to operate in, hence why we need to get the Raspberry Pi booted with a 64-bit kernel. So, as I say, we're building bin utils and GCC. They'll be running and executing 32-bit code on the Raspberry Pi, but there'll be the output will be some executables that are capable of running on the 32-bit Pi, but their output is the for 64-bit ARM So that's what the target is for. So we need these two pages here to tell us, well, they don't tell us what to do, but they give, I use them as hints. I've adjusted just a few of the switches and options that these pages give. They're a good guide, especially the GCC one, because it turns off a lot of options and it saves a bit of time and it's stuff we don't need. So it's a good way of following it. The other page, the final page we need is this all packages, because that's got the URLs for the packages that we need to build. So if we scroll down here and look for bin utils, right click that and do copy link address, type in wget, paste that address in, and do the same for GCC. So copy that link address there, paste that in, and what I'll do is just press enter and wait for those to download. Should just be a minute or so. Okay, so those two files have downloaded. We don't need this tab anymore. So the first package we're going to build is bin utils. So what we need to do first is to extract the source package we've just downloaded. You can, if you want, if I go back to the packages, if you want to double check, which is that tab there, that link there, sorry. You can validate the checksums if you like. That might be a sensible thing to do. So MD5 sum star dot XZ, I presume they're both XZ. Yep, they are. So you can just double check bin utils. You see it starts 628D. So does our one here, and it ends 29D4. So that's good enough. I won't bother checking the other digits. It should be the same. And GCC starts with E9FD, and where has it gone? Ends with 96B50. So they've downloaded okay, they've not been tampered with. So that's fine. So again, let's go back to bin utils and extract the bin utils source package. Now bear in mind, this is booted off the SD card. It's just a default installation. All I've done is updated it. So you'll see, like for example now, it will pause for a while every now and then, and that's because the SD card is being written to. It's slow when being written to. But the actual Gentoo installation, I'll be creating that on an external drive over the USB 3 port. So it should be a lot faster. Okay, so that's that package extracted. So what we'll do now is change directory into that package and create a build directory to work in. And then we can run this configure command. So this is a bit that's going to be different. Now the thing is, if we for start off, if we just run this command in, we haven't defined this LFS variable, so it will default to nothing and the prefix will install into tools. So that may not be a bad thing, but it's probably better to put it somewhere a bit more sensible, like the opt directory for optional programs. So I shall do that, just paste that part in, set the prefix to /opt /, and I'm going to call it ARM64-XC4 to show me that it's a cross-compiled for the ARM architecture. Then the other options, we don't need the sysroot. The target's important because we need to tell the compiler what the target architecture is. And in this case, if you remember, I said before, the 64-bit is AARCH64. So that's ARM Architecture 64, I imagine it stands for. -Linux, -gnu. And then we can disable the, is it national language system? I think that NLS don't care about any sort of country stuff or language stuff. When I was doing my testing, I didn't actually use this disabler, but let's stick it in anyway. I don't think it'll make that much difference. So we'll just run that in. It'll configure the bin utils package. And now we can compile the package with make. I'll just time this to get an idea of how long it takes, because whatever time this takes, when we come to do GCC, if you multiply the time by the figure that's at the top of the page of GCC, so it's got 11 here. So, for example, it took 1 minute here to build bin utils. It's an estimate, as it says, it's approximate. It'll take approximately 11 minutes to build GCC. So it's a good idea to time this just to get an idea. So yeah, we're going to run the make in, and I'll put in -J4 to use all four cores of the Raspberry Pi, and press enter and wait for that to build, and say it's about a minute or two to build this package. Okay, so that's finished, and it took just under 4 minutes. I showed under 4 minutes. So what I need to do is run make install, and this should hopefully install into the ops directory. So we should see that. Yeah, I've just seen it flash past. We can check it afterwards to see what it's done. Yeah, there's a command there. So let's have a look at the ops directory. There's the ARM64XE directory that I specified with today's date and time. And I can look inside that. And you can see there's a few directories in there. There's the architecture we specified, and one in particular that's important is this bin one, because that's where all the executables have been put. So all these programs will execute on a 32-bit ARM, but they're designed to produce output that's compatible with a 64-bit ARM, hence the prefix at the front of each of one of these. So we can now go back to the home directory and tidy this up. And the next thing we must do before we carry on with the GCC compile is extremely important, because if we don't do this part, then what we do next just won't matter at all. And that's to put the path of these binaries into the system path so that these binaries are picked up. And to do that, all we need to do is to set the path to equal that path in opt ARM64XE bin, and then tack on the existing path onto the end. So if we now display the contents of the path, you can see that the first things that anything will search for will be in this bin directory that we've just generated code for. And then it will look at the rest of the system paths for any programs that need to be run. So that's really important to get that done before we carry on with GCC. So now let's carry on with GCC and first of all extract the tarball that was downloaded. Now there's lots of options for GCC. I've played around with a lot of them, so I'm going to have to check to make sure I don't leave anything out. Let's get rid of that bin utils tab, we don't need that anymore. Now we don't need to do this first bit because we installed those development packages, if you remember MPFR, GMP and MPC, so they're on the system. We don't need to run this bit of code because it's all to, as you can see, all to do with Intel architecture 64-bit or AMD 64 if you like. So we'll start from this point here when the tarball has extracted. Right, so that's extracted. First thing to do is to change into the directory we've just extracted. Now we can run this make dir build and change into it. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to record the previous configure command just so that I've got the exact same path. I don't have to type it in or copy it in or anything. I've got the exact same path, so there's no doubt that this is going in the same place. And then I need to put in the... I've deleted it. Let's try to get that back again. I need to put the target back in. So, yeah, I'll just delete up to there instead. So the target's going to be the same as before, arch dash linux dash, sorry, arch 64 dash linux dash gnu. So that's the target and the prefix sorted out. Now, the with glibc, I did alter this a little bit to the current version of glibc that the Raspberry Pi has got. It doesn't matter if when you come to do this that the glibc has been updated again. You could put in that version if you knew it, or if you don't know it, you don't need to worry that that this needs to be changed. All this does is specifies the minimum version of glibc. So this is version 2.11. The version of glibc on the Pi is 2.28, so I just thought I'll use 2.28 in case it provides any advantages, rather than 2.11, which is the minimum that the Linux from scratch team support with their method for compiling a Linux operating system. The sysroot I didn't bother with, so let me just go down these. I'm pretty sure I used these. Let me just check them. So with nulib, without headers, enable init fini array, disable NLS. Did I use that? I'm pretty sure I would have done. Oh yes, there it is. Disable shared. Yep. Disable multilib. Yep. This one float. Yep. Threads. Libatomic. Libgomp. Libquadmath. SSP. Libvtv. Libstandard CXS. Yep. I think the rest of this is the same then. So the only bits I changed were the three items you can see on the screen now, which is the prefix, the target, and the glibc version. So what I should do is put a space in there, I'll paste this lot in, and press enter. And that's the configure done. So once again, I'm going to run make with the minus J4 so that it uses all four cores for more speed. And this looks like it's going to take about roughly 30 to 40 minutes, judging by the estimates. So when that's done, I'll come back and we'll carry on. Okay, so that's finished compiling. So all we need to do now is to install it, and again this should install into the opt directory that we specified. So let's do it now. Make install. So again, this is just pausing while it's writing to the SD card. Okay, so that's done. Let's have another look at our ops directory. So there's one or two extra directories there, and if we look in the bin directory, we've now got quite a few more binaries. In particular is the compiler itself there, that one there. So that looks like that's all worked okay. So all we need to do now is to just tidy up. Go back to the root, rm-rf, gcc. Okay, so that's done with Linux from scratch. We've built our cross-compiler that we need. So the next thing is to go to this kernel building page for the Raspberry Pi, because it will give us some hints on where to get the kernel from, as well as how to build it. So near the top there's a link here which takes you to the GitHub repository, which is this page here. Now if you download directly from this, this is the version that's updated daily, basically, as and when. You can see this directory had some updates just yesterday. What's probably safest to do is if you click on this link here, click on tags, and then click view all tags. And these are like releases of the kernel that have been tagged. So if you now click on this link here, which is the most recent one, it shows the source code that's been compiled up for this particular release that was tagged. So you can either save it from within the browser, or you can do what I've done, just copy the link and use wget to fetch the file. Either way will do. So we'll just wait for this tarball to download. So although it's not bang up to date, at least in theory it should be a reasonably stable version. So that's coming down quite slow, actually. Not sure why. Just wait to see if it picks up speed a little bit. actually going to see if I can stop that and retry it, see if it'll get a better connection. Oh, it just, typical, it just jumped up to megabytes just as I, right, let's remove that and start again. Raspberry Pi. Actually, I'm not sure if we could, might be able to use a continue command. See if that works. Yep, seems to be. Yeah, that's a bit better. So I'm not sure what happened there. Okay, so that looks like that's downloaded okay. So what we need to do next is to extract that file. So let's do that. Right, so that has extracted, so what we'll do now is to change into that. So let's now go to the kernel building page, which will give us some, let's say, some hints on to what to do here. So we're cross-compiling, we've now got a cross-compiler, we've fetched the sources. So for Raspberry Pi 4, which is basically what the Raspberry Pi 400 is, 64-bit, these are the commands we need to use. So we've changed into the Linux sources. This is the name of the kernel. Now what we can do is we can suffix this with something a little bit different. In fact, no, I'll leave that as kernel 8. We can rename it if we need to. So I'll leave that as kernel 8. So that sets that variable. Then we've got this make command where certain things are specified. So this is the configuration for the Raspberry Pi 400. The only thing we need to alter here is the cross compiler. We need to tell it where it is, so it's in opt ARM64XC/bin. And as you can see, they specify the prefix there, including the dash, and then anything after that dash is the actual program name itself, so we just leave it like that. So run make, and this will configure the package. And then to build, it's exactly the same command, except that I'm going to put in a minus J4 here to use all four cores. I'm also going to time this. And instead of this BCM2711 def config, we've got three targets here, the image itself, the modules, and the binaries that get packaged up as well. So just paste that in, and we wait for this to build. so that has built to just under 80 minutes. So what we need to do now is to take bits of this and install them. So we've got the boot already mounted because that's mounted automatically. My keyboard has gone to sleep again. Right, that's it. So you can see there's all this stuff there. We're going to copy some stuff into this and overwrite what's there with this version we're building for. And this is the command we want to do first to install the modules. Now, notice it's got an install mod path. We don't need to put that in because they're assuming that the system is mounted at the different points. We don't need to put that bit in. In fact, we could probably just recall the command again. I'll take out the minus J4, that's probably not needed. So the beginning is make arch equals arm 64, cross compile is the same. So it's just modules installed we need to add on the end of this. Okay, I don't know, my keyboard's a little bit slow. And just wait for them to install. Okay, so the next bit is to copy the actual kernel image, and I'm not going to copy that at the moment because I'll do that in the next video for the benefit of the people who haven't watched this video, because we will need to tweak around the kernel. In fact, I can copy it. It's the activation of it I won't be able to do at the moment. It'll have to be done in the next video. So we need to copy... Well, it's saying to back up the existing kernel, so let's do that. MV boot. So it's, we've still got this variable, have we? Don't like it. Echo. Oops, spell it right. Oh, it is there, okay. It's just not completing with the bash completions. So. Move the $kernel and we'll call that like they've called it to boot $kernel dot backup. Sorry, dot image dot img and dot img. So if we now look at the boot again, what was kernel8.image is now kernel8.image.backup, and we can now, in fact, I can copy this command, it shouldn't be any different. Copy the kernel we've just created into the boot, permission denied. Oh, okay. This bit here, that should be boot. No, it still doesn't like it. It's not allowing us to read the image. That's strange. Let's take a look to see why that might be. So there's nothing wrong with the permissions there. Just check to see if the boot's mounted read right. Okay, I don't know if the batteries need changing in my keyboard. It seems to be a little bit sluggish. Let's just give them a little whiz. Right, that seems to be better. It looks like it's mounted read right, so can't see why that's a particular problem. Oh dear, it's obvious. Let's give this a command. It's trying to execute it. Right, that's better. So now let's go to the listing of the boot, and you can see there's our new kernel there. It's a lot bigger than the old one. I believe the kernel is not compressed for the 64-bit for some reason, although I don't know why that's why it's a lot bigger. Maybe there's a lot more built into it, but that's not a problem. It's okay, it looks good. So the next thing we need to do is to copy these files, which needs to go in the same place as the kernel, which is boot. Okay, yeah. My keyboard's playing up again. So I'll have to try and find a wired one. So we'll copy those. And now these in theory shouldn't be any different, but the only difference would be from whether the kernel installed is slightly older than the one that's just been built, but that shouldn't really be the case because, as I say, the system is up to date. So again, this next line gets copied into boot, but this time, just move that across, you can see it gets copied to overlays. Okay, and then the only difference with the next bit is a README file. So let's copy that. I imagine that's got licensing information. And that should be it. So, the rest of this I'll do on the next video because it will pertain to those who have followed this video building the kernel from scratch, or whether the viewers are those who have just decided to use the one that was already on the system. So that's it for this video. We'll actually install and reboot and use the kernel in the next video, and then we can start actually building Gentoo right from the very beginning. So thank you for watching, and hope it's been educational. Please like the video if it has been, and subscribe to my channel if you've not done so already. Cheerio.